Highbridge, a division of Recorded Books, presents Murder at the Mena House by Erica Ruth Neubauer. Read by Sarah Zimmerman. Chapter 1. Egypt, 1926. When selecting an exotic location for travel, it's advisable to choose one where the air isn't trying to kill you. I would try to remember that for the next time.
Jane, you look terrible in this heat. You're practically dripping.
My Aunt Millie's mouth puckered, but also slipped into a smug little grin at the edges. She looked as fresh as linen off the line, without so much as a glisten. I sighed inwardly. I didn't realize how hot it was still going to be this time of year. I eyed the long, wide blades of the fans as they turned lazily overhead. I decided they were more for appearance than actually moving any of the heavy air around. Millie sniffed and went back to surveying the bar, whiskey highball firmly in hand, lipstick now slightly askew with a matching plum-colored scowl on the rim of the glass. My aunt's first order of business upon our recent arrival at the Mena House Hotel had been a drink, any drink. As long as it was a step above the bathtub rot being churned out at home. Prohibition was my aunt's arch nemesis. With Millie sorted out, I excused myself to go in search of a drink of my own. I threaded through the thin crowd to the bar and leaned against the polished wood. It felt good to stand after hours of travel, and I surreptitiously stretched as I waited for my gin Ricky. Within moments, the young bartender appeared at my elbow with my drink. I hoped the cool lime and refreshing fizz would wash away the sandy grit of travel from my mouth. My aunt had barely let us settle into our rooms before bustling me down to the bar. It hadn't even been enough time to catch a glimpse of the Great Pyramids I knew were just outside this hotel. I surveyed our fellow travelers at the bar, stopping myself from slugging my drink back in one go. I was more parched than I had thought.
Mrs. Wunderly, I presume?
The low, pleasant rumble interrupted my gawking at the scene around me, nearly startling me out of my skin. I turned and faced the broad-shouldered owner of the posh British accent that addressed me. As my hazel eyes met dark chocolate ones, a frisson of electricity traveled down my spine before I tamped it down. Hard. Handsome men were not my concern. He nearly towered over me, and I was not a small woman by any standard. I eyed him, one eyebrow cocked, wondering how he had discovered my name before any introductions had been made. Perhaps he had some magic at his fingertips. Another shiver tickled my spine. Well, you've pulled my name from a hat. Will you be performing any more tricks this evening? Pull a coin from my ear, perhaps? I could use one to pay for this drink, frankly. One corner of his mouth turned up.
Your aunt mentioned you when she introduced herself to me just now.
That was fast, I muttered and cursed my inattentiveness. I wasn't at all surprised that my aunt had sniffed him out and then sent him over, especially once she realized he wasn't wearing a wedding band, which I cursed myself for noticing also. I was just surprised she had managed to do it so quickly.
I'm afraid no further tricks will be forthcoming.
Well, that is a disappointment.
All I can offer you in exchange for your loss is another drink.
I suppose I will have to make do. A full smile lit his already handsome face, and I gave myself a small shake and a stern lecture on the perils of men while he turned and gestured to the bartender. He ordered another gin Ricky for me and a glass of water for himself. This time, when my drink appeared, it was generously poured, too generously. I would have to take it slow, or I would find myself zazzled and lying beneath a table. Not drinking? I eyed his water, tiny drops of condensation making their way to the bar from where his long fingers rested on the glass.
I had a long day in the sun, he said. Sticking with water seems a safer bet.
I see.
I paused and studied him for a moment. And what line of work are you in, Mr.? I suddenly realized he hadn't introduced himself.
Redvers, call me Redvers.
He revealed a roguish grin as both of my eyebrows headed north. Was that a given name? A surname? It seemed I wasn't going to get any clarification on that point. And what is it you do, Mr. Redvers?
I'm in banking.
I'm embarrassed to say I burst out laughing. He looked slightly alarmed, as if he had suddenly come across an unbalanced relative out in public. More than a few heads turned our way. My apologies. I got hold of myself, mentally kicking myself for my rudeness. You simply look too dangerous to be a banker. And he did. His suit was of fine linen and perfectly fit his athletic frame. Even my untrained eye could see that it was tailor-made and expensive. His dark hair was slicked in the current style, but the thick waves were giving him a great deal of trouble in taming them. He was all energy and movement, and the wolfish grin he was now giving me, along with the sparkling intelligence in his brown, nearly black eyes, gave the impression of someone who was most definitely not trapped behind a desk counting money. We continued chatting amiably before a brief lull in the conversation prompted me to offer him an out. You know, Mr. Redvers, if you have other obligations this evening, I very much understand. I know my aunt can be persuasive, but I would hate to keep you. It was his turn to study me.
I admit that it was your aunt's suggestion that I introduce myself, but I'm quite happy where I am.
I shrugged. Against my better judgment, I found myself enjoying his company and didn't entirely mind prolonging it. But I also didn't want to give him the wrong impression. Even though I was past what society considered my prime, I had done my fair share of shooting down offers since I had been widowed. And depending on the man, they didn't always take the rejection gracefully. I was not looking for anything outside of a pleasant conversation, as I kept reminding myself. But Mr. Redvers had a sharp sense of humor, something that I had sorely missed back home. The society circles that Millie moved in were stuffy, to say the least. My father's family was solidly upper middle class, but with Millie's high society marriage and then my own at the tender age of 20, it was impossible to avoid being dragged into the upper echelons of society alongside her. Just the thought of those proper circles made my eyes cross with boredom. Redver's eyes caught on something behind my shoulder, and he suddenly looked apologetic.
But I'm afraid I do need to excuse myself for a moment. I shall return shortly.
I raised my eyebrows, but excused him gracefully. I wondered what, or who, could have called him away as soon as he had announced he was staying. I returned to my perusal of the room. Within moments, I felt a presence behind me and turned to find a mustachioed gentleman leaning on a wooden cane. As he readjusted his broad hands, I caught a glimpse of the brass lion head perched on top of the dark mahogany stick. It looked both fierce and substantial.
"Good evening, my dear,"
he smiled graciously.
"Having any luck getting a refreshment?"
I smiled at him, immediately put at ease by his demeanor. "I'm all set for the present, but the bartender has been quite attentive."
"Excellent." He caught the young man's eye. "A sherry, if you would."
He turned to me, extending his hand.
"Colonel Justice Stainton, at your service."
His clipped British vowels and upright bearing would have given away his military background, even if his title hadn't. "Jane Wunderly." I gave his hand a firm shake. His gentle blue eyes widened slightly at my grip, and my smile widened in response. He cleared his throat.
"What brings you to the Mena house, Miss Wunderly?"
According to social mores, the proper address would have been Mrs., but I didn't bother to correct him. I would rather eat hot coals than discuss my widowed status with friends, let alone perfect strangers. And I was tired of facing the pity that comes with losing one's husband in the Great War. Of course, even more dreaded were the questions from people whose false concern masked their desire for proximity to drama. I didn't get that sense from the colonel, but sleeping dogs and all that. My aunt and I are traveling together. I gestured with my free hand to Millie, who took no notice of me, but appeared quite pleased now that her hand was holding a full drink again. Quality liquor and a warm climate had been Millie's only two requirements when she had suggested that I accompany her on a trip, at her expense no less. And while I also relished the idea of enjoying some gin without the threat of going blind, I was beyond thrilled to fulfill a lifelong dream to see the pyramids. And yourself?
I wanted to show my daughter, Anna, that there was more to the world than parties in London and young men with money.
A wry smile curled the edges of his bottle-brush mustache as he nodded in Anna's direction, where she stood nursing a drink, eyeing the crowd. Her brassy blonde bob glowed in the gentle bar light, although it had that brittle quality that comes with too many applications of peroxide. Her boyish figure was perfectly suited to display the current fashions. Even from a distance, I could see that the young lady's heavily beaded and short navy blue dress was nothing short of couture. Looking her over, I had to admit to a small stab of jealousy. My figure was far more suited to an era that appreciated padded curves. It's been mentioned by Millie more than once that perhaps I should consider one of the lightweight corsets to bring my curves into a more fashionable line. The current trend in drop-waist dresses looked terrible on anyone who was not built like a lollipop or willing to constrict themselves into the shape of one. I enjoyed breathing far too much to try. I turned back to the colonel and returned his smile. She's lovely. His face lit with pride. And rich young men are better than the alternative, I suppose. He chuckled, and our small talk quickly turned to our mutual interest in local historical sites and current digs.
I'm happy to share with you what I know about the area. The colonel's eyes danced. We've been here for several weeks already, and I was stationed nearby during the war. Were you planning to do some touring soon? It would be my pleasure to offer my services to you and your aunt.
I was planning on giving myself a day or two to get acclimated to the heat and then take a tour with a local guide. As anxious as I was to see the pyramids, I knew that I would enjoy them more if I gave myself a chance to get used to the weather first. But I would love to take you up on your offer. It's very kind of you.
Excellent. Let's plan on it then.
His gaze drifted over my shoulder and his left eye twitched ever so slightly. I turned my head and quickly located the source of his irritation. Anna had found a group of three fashionably dressed young men of varying degrees of attractiveness. Her giggles carried down the bar like brittle bubbles, breaking over us as the gentlemen jostled each other for her attention. The tallest of the bunch bent to light her cigarette, and I could see her fluttering her lashes.
If you will excuse me, Miss Wunderly.
I smiled graciously as the colonel moved down the bar toward Anna. A voice rumbled in my ear almost immediately.
Hello again.
Chapter 2. I had been entirely caught up in the scene Anna was creating and was startled once more. Hand to my heart, I turned to find that Redvers, true to his word, had returned. Are you certain you're not a magician? That was an excellent reappearing trick.
Simply the gift of stealth.
I've known tigers with less stealth than you, then.
And you're acquainted with many tigers?
Only my fair share. Redvers paused for a moment, glancing down the bar.
Who were you chatting with?
Colonel Stainton. He introduced himself. I studied Redvers for a moment, but his face remained impassive. It seemed entirely too convenient that Redvers had disappeared when he saw the colonel coming and reappeared just as quickly. But what reason could he have for avoiding the man? With a mental shrug, I went on to explain what I had told the colonel about our recent arrival and travel plans, and soon found myself once again discussing my interest in archaeology and its modern relevance. It wasn't long before our polite discussion dissolved into a heated debate of the current political climate,
and I was taking pointed jabs at the British. But don't you admit that the continued occupation of this country is outrageous? They declared sovereignty 3 years ago, but the British government is still running interference. Redvers laughed.
That seems awfully hypocritical coming from an American. Do you know how many colonies you have? Besides, without our interference, the current system may well collapse entirely.
He made an excellent point. My own position was largely due to naivete about nuanced world politics, so I changed courses. Is that why you're here? To bring a better banking system?
Oh my, you're a banker. Does that mean you have a lot of money outside the bank as well?
Damn the man. I had failed to notice that I was being flanked, this time by Anna Stanton herself. I was annoyed at the interruption, but managed to smooth my face into a pleasant smile long before she bothered to flick a glance my way. Redvers, much too observant, caught me and seemed amused.
Well, it's not as simple as that.
He turned to face Anna fully. Miss Stanton, I presume.
Oh, please call me Anna.
She put her hand on his arm, and I just barely managed to keep my eyes from rolling. Instead, I turned back to the bar to ask for a glass of water. Two large fizzy drinks had obviously played havoc with my self-control, and it was time to get my equilibrium back. As Anna continued to coo questions in Redvers' direction, I considered excusing myself. I was not going to fight for a man's attention, any man, but I especially did not want to battle with a woman nearly 10 years younger than I, and obviously on the hunt. Farther down the bar, I spotted a caramel-skinned man wearing a pristine white linen suit. He was now staring in our direction, and for a moment, I worried that I was the object of his intense gaze. Then I realized it was Anna's back he was burning holes in. I turned to ask whether either of my companions knew the man when I felt a sudden deluge of cold liquid down the front of my dress and heard the tinkle of a few stray ice cubes fall at my feet. I sighed as I looked down at my now soaked chest. It was no accident. I had seen Anna's hand tip her glass while she watched me out of the corner of her eye. In fact, it was quite a feat, as I stood nearly a head taller, and yet she managed to hit me directly in the chest. My initial shock turned briefly to rage, and just as quickly I tamped it down. I refused to be upset by this young woman. In fact, I almost had to admire her. It was a very efficient way to rid herself of competition for Redvers' attention. He was, after all, the most attractive man in the room. It was merely an observation. Not an interest. I would never admit it, but the cold seeping into my clothing felt rather good. It was still a warm evening. I was, however, relieved that I had changed into darker attire before dinner. Sheer fabric and liquids are not exactly a recipe for modesty.
Oh, I'm dreadfully sorry, Anna said without a trace of sincerity.
Not a problem, I said. I'll just pop back to my room to change. I hope I haven't ruined that charming blouse. I nearly laughed. A cat with claws embedded in my leg couldn't have been more obvious. Instead, I smiled widely. If it makes you feel better, I'll send the cleaning bill to your room. I was about to excuse myself when I saw a flash of white linen pass by us, bumping Anna's arm from behind, causing her to lose her grasp on the silver beaded clutch she held there. The clasp broke open as it made contact with the floor, and both she and I immediately bent to retrieve her things. Backed against the bar, Redvers couldn't bend to assist us, but he helpfully pushed some items toward me with his neatly polished wingtips. I gathered the items nearest me, a tube of lipstick, a compact that miraculously seemed intact, and some stray coins. As I passed her items back to her, she quickly stuffed everything back into her bag. Then she gave the clasp a decidedly firm click, pressed her lips together, and glared at me. We could have stared at each other all evening long, but a thank you was never going to pass those ruby lips. I decided it was the perfect time to make an exit, and I bid them both a good night. As I wove through the crowd, I kept an eye out for the white linen suit that had collided with Anna, but he had disappeared just as quickly as he had appeared.
I was sure it was the man I had seen staring at Anna, but I couldn't imagine why he would have purposely spilled Anna's purse. And it had certainly looked intentional. Selfishly, I felt a twinge of relief that it hadn't been my own public display this time. I was not a stranger to embarrassing myself with clumsiness. Aunt Millie was chatting with two young women at a table as I passed by. I waved a hand at my soaked shirt front. Millie gave a quick, exasperated glance to the heavens and continued with her conversation. I had no idea how many drinks she had under her belt, but I wasn't worried about her. I knew she could manage on her own. The majority of the guests had either retired for the evening or were peppered around the bar, leaving the moonlit hallways empty as I passed through. The heels of my shoes clicked conspicuously against marble and echoed slightly in the quiet, and I acknowledged to myself that the sound made me a little jumpy. The hotel was an absolute maze, and I didn't know where the gentleman in the white suit had disappeared to. Empty doorways opened onto dark and mysterious paths, and I found myself hurrying a bit as I passed each one. I could see the intersection where I needed to turn toward my room, but as I passed yet another dark doorway, a hand shot out and touched my arm. I shrieked and stumbled forward. Chapter 3.
"Oh, my dear Miss Wunderly, I'm so sorry to have startled you." The colonel's brows furrowed. "I saw you passing by and thought I would catch up with you. I would like to apologize for my Anna. I heard what happened in the bar just now."
He managed to keep his eyes on mine and away from the damp lake of my blouse. A true gentleman. Hand to my chest, I could feel my heart racing, but I smiled and reassured him that I was fine. I'm certain she didn't mean it. It was just an unfortunate accident. A small lie on my part, but an innocent one. There was no sense in stirring up trouble with Anna's father. I dropped my hand and surreptitiously wiped my damp palm on my skirt. He smiled somewhat sadly.
"I'm sure it was. She seems difficult, but she has had such a rough go of things since... well, she is easily wound up."
He failed to elaborate, and I didn't press him. It was an easy assumption that their family had suffered some sort of loss, most likely during the war. Everyone's lives had been affected in some way. "I'm certain it was just an accident, and truly, Colonel, no harm done." I paused. "I'm sure I will see you at some time tomorrow. Please have a pleasant night." He smiled, obviously relieved, and patted my arm clumsily as he turned to go. I watched for a moment as he ambled down the long hallway, cane tapping, before I headed on my way. The wet shirt I wore was becoming more than a little uncomfortable in the rapidly cooling night air. I prayed I could make it back to my rooms without running into anyone else. Carrying on a conversation while wearing a soaked blouse was awkward, to say the least. Once in my room, I stripped off the soiled clothes and rinsed them in the adjoining bath. Whatever Anna had been drinking was strong enough to leave a lingering odor, and I didn't want either my clothes or my rooms to smell like a speakeasy. Once I was confident the smell had disappeared down the drain, I hung them over the edge of the tub, making a mental note to have them taken to be cleaned properly. Fortunately, whatever Anna had been drinking was light in color, so I felt confident it wouldn't stain. Instead of changing into another set of clothes for the evening, I decided to turn in for the night. Several days of travel, the excitement of the evening, and the mystery of a very foreign country left me barely able to keep my eyes open. I collapsed onto the soft bed and fell into a dreamless sleep. The next morning, I awoke early and dressed in what I supposed would become my Egyptian uniform, a light cotton sleeveless blouse and loose-fitting skirt, and headed down to breakfast alone. I figured Aunt Millie would be sleeping off the effects of last night, so I didn't bother to check with her. I felt certain the first I would see of her would be sometime around lunch. I walked slowly on my way to the breakfast room, pausing to admire the architecture as I pass through arabesque doorways, dark and light marble alternating to form striking stripes around the rims. I ran my fingers over the cool marble, the smooth surface rolling beneath my fingertips. In the daylight, the same doorways had none of the menace from the night before, and I laughed a bit at myself. The hotel was nothing but beautiful. As I continued on, I noticed the potted palms scattered throughout the hotel, bringing warmth and life to the marble surroundings. Within moments of my arrival at the dining room, I was greeted by a dark-skinned man with raven-black hair, just beginning to show the signs of gray at his temples. He wore the customary long white robes of the hotel staff, but his ensemble was topped with a round felt hat in a rich red, a gold tassel hanging merrily along the side. His large dark eyes were warm and creased at the corners, framed with the kind of eyelashes a woman would kill for.
"Good morning, ma'am," he said in beautifully accented English. "My name is Zaki, and I am the head waiter here at the Mena House. Please, come this way."
As he showed me to my table, I couldn't help but gape at the dining room I was being led into. It was a sight to behold. Designed to create the impression of a mosque's interior, it was unlike anything I'd ever seen in a hotel, or anywhere for that matter. Numerous lamps of pierced metal hung from the high-domed ceiling, casting fascinating shadows on the white linen tablecloths and sparkling silverware below. The walls, windows, and ceiling were covered with stunning fretted woodwork, carved in intricate designs. As we passed, I could see Arabic inscriptions worked into the patterns. "Zaki, what are these beautiful wooden panels?" I asked, gesturing to the walls. He held my chair for me, then pushed it in gently before handing me the morning menu.
"Ah, you have excellent taste, madame. They are called mashrabias and were hand-carved by very fine artisans. They were popular many hundreds of years ago. The panels you see here were saved from a nearby town by the new owners of this hotel." He beamed at me. "If you have other questions, I'm always happy to help. I will send someone to take your order right away. Please enjoy your breakfast."
"Thank you, Zaki." I decided on a simple breakfast of eggs and toast, handing over my menu and my order before taking in the rest of the room. There weren't as many people as I'd expected, even given the relatively early hour, but it was late September and the end of the off-season. The warm weather in the winter and spring would surely bring more tourists from both the states and the continent, but for now few had found reason to escape their own reasonable climates. I wondered if we had been right to come so early in the season, but I comforted myself with the hope that the tourist sites would be less clogged with visitors. After my quiet breakfast, I settled myself in the shade of a large palm on the wide terrace behind the hotel. A postcard scene of the pyramids floating above the trees stretched out before me, and I found myself distracted by the view and the possibilities. I looked forward to exploring the pyramids and perhaps even some of the archaeological dig sites in the area. I made a mental note to ask the colonel later if he had any special recommendations. I had just picked up the book I'd brought along when my Aunt Millie appeared before me. "Aunt Millie?" I was unable to hide my surprise. "I didn't expect that you would be up yet."
"My dear girl, one can't lie about all day.
I realize we're spending a fair amount of time here, but it would be a waste to spend it in bed. These ladies are going to accompany me for a round of golf."
I was so startled by Millie's early appearance that I'd completely failed to notice two things: that my aunt had dressed in something resembling athletic wear, and the two young ladies from the evening before were trailing in her wake.
"This is Miss Lillian Hughes," Millie indicated the tall, trim girl with auburn hair, who smiled a greeting at me but seemed preoccupied, her eyes straying towards something beyond the tree line. "And this is Miss Marie Collins." Marie briefly raised a hand in greeting, but her eyes barely strayed from Lillian.
"How do you do, ladies? It's a pleasure," I said. "I didn't know you played golf, Aunt Millie."
"I suspect there are a great many things you don't know about me, Jane.
Millie gave a playful smile and threaded Lillian's arm through her own. Lillian smiled at Millie, and the pair migrated in the direction of the golf course, with Marie trailing slightly behind. My mouth was still agape as they disappeared from view. I had never seen Millie so physically affectionate with anyone, and I could not begin to imagine what Millie had in common with two young British women barely in their 20s. Except golf, apparently. Once I stood, I could see the green grass of the course lying in striking contrast to the gold sand all around. I hadn't realized that there was a golf course at the hotel. It never occurred to me that something so green could survive in the middle of the desert. Even though I knew logically that Egypt wasn't entirely sand, it had the Nile, after all. "Not one for golf, Mrs. Wunderly," I started, then realized that Redvers had appeared at my side, stealthy as per usual. I truly needed to work on my powers of observation if I was going to survive the barrage of surprises. "I've never been one for sporting pursuits. Of any kind." I could feel a red stain creeping up my neck. I ignored it as I sat back down, gesturing for him to join me. "Would you like some coffee, Mr. Redvers? The local brew is quite good. Or would you prefer a cuppa?" He cocked an eyebrow at the British colloquialism. "My mother was English," I explained. "Ah," he said, "but you failed to acquire the taste for tea. I'm afraid it's fine for the afternoons, but I require something a bit stiffer in the morning. You never did answer my question. Can I order something for you?" "No, I'm afraid not, Mrs. Wunderly. I have business in town this morning and was just passing through, although I would like to continue our conversation over a drink this evening, if you're available. I was disappointed when you didn't return last night. As much as I didn't care what this handsome and somewhat mysterious man thought of me, I was pleased that he had noticed my absence. Of course, I was also somewhat appalled at my forward behavior the previous night. You enjoy having a woman argue politics with you?" I hid behind my cup as I took a sip and avoided looking at him. "I prefer an argument with an intelligent woman over 2 minutes in the company of a simpering one." "Well, I can assure you that I never simper." "No, I can't imagine that you would." I smiled at him, despite myself. Redvers retrieved his bone-white Panama hat from its place on the table and made to leave. "Until tonight, then." I realized I had never answered his initial question and lost a brief internal struggle over whether to turn him down. I didn't want to give him the wrong idea, but it also appeared that my aunt had her own agenda, and I might find myself more at loose ends during this trip than I had expected. It couldn't hurt to have a few friendly faces in the crowd. "It would be my pleasure, Mr. Redvers. Until tonight," I said. He rose and gave a slight bow before disappearing into the cool shadows of the building. I pretended to return to my book as I discreetly watched him over the top of the pages. But as soon as he disappeared from view, my mind turned back to Millie, a woman I would have wagered could not surprise me. I would have lost that bet. Chapter 4. I spent the remainder of the morning on the terrace, alternately enjoying the spectacular view and reading Agatha Christie's The Man in the Brown Suit. I came up for air after a particularly riveting scene and realized that I was developing a slight headache. The unseen birds, which had earlier called to each other from their shady perches, quieted as the sun moved higher overhead, and the day was now beginning to swelter. Escaping to my darkened room suddenly sounded glorious. An hour later, I emerged from my room to join Millie for a quiet lunch on her private terrace. "Are you pleased with your rooms?" Millie's suite, with its private veranda, faced the pyramids themselves. My rooms were several doors down and on the opposite side of the hall. They had a lovely view of the gardens, but nothing compared to her spectacular panorama. Millie gave a careless glance around. "They are sufficient."
I resisted the urge to roll my eyes. Although I had been surprised my aunt suggested the Mena house for our stay, in my experience, she was more likely to prefer the more socially positioned hotels in Cairo itself, like Shepherd's or the Continental. But I was delighted with the location. Flat roofs at multiple heights broke up the long, white facade of the building, and the numerous balconies gave it a distinctly Arabian feel. Not to mention, it was directly in the shadow of the Great Pyramids. It was also the only hotel in Egypt with a pool, which definitely added to its appeal. If the weather continued in this vein, I suspected I would be living in the pool before too long. We settled ourselves in the padded chairs on the terrace. Mind-reading mystic that she was, Millie brought up the very subject I was hoping to avoid. "Well, Jane, how was your little chat with Mr. Redvers?" "It was fine." She fixed me with a disapproving glare. "I would hate to see you ruin this opportunity. I'm afraid there don't seem to be many other eligible men here, Jane." "Well, it's a good thing I'm not looking for any." I turned my attention to the lunch menu. I caught her disapproving look over the top. "It's been plenty of time since Grant passed, Jane. Time to move on." I kept my eyes pasted on the menu and prayed she would drop it. She didn't drop it. "If only Nigel's dear nephew had survived the war, you wouldn't be..." She lowered her voice into a whisper, as if discussing a sin in church. "In your 30s and still alone. And surely you and Grant would have had children by now." She sighed dramatically. "To be widowed at only 22 and left childless. You're running out of time to have them, Jane." Tension crept up my spine and took root in my shoulders. I rolled them back one at a time before searching out an alternate topic of conversation. "Will you look at this menu? So much to choose from. What do you think you'll have?" Millie grumbled, noisily, but allowed herself to be distracted. Unfortunately, there was no doubt in my mind she would return to this particular battle. I knew Millie. She would never lay down her sword for good. She made her choice, and I phoned our order to the kitchen downstairs. While we waited, I tried to draw my aunt out about her morning playing golf with the girls, but she was unusually reserved on the topic, refusing anything but the briefest answers. I finally gave up and hoped that whatever was bothering her would resolve itself. I spent the remainder of the time soaking up her view. After lunch, I returned to my rooms and my novel, but after a time, I became restless and ventured out again. A slow wander through the hushed halls soon brought me upon the colonel. He was dressed in what my mother used to call short pants, with a khaki shirt and a pith helmet, looking for all the world like he was going on safari. His cane was at the ready.
"Good afternoon, my dear Miss Wunderly." He tipped his hat to me. "Have you spent a pleasant day?"
"I did, although I had to escape from the heat for a bit."
"It's the best thing, the only thing, really. Until you get used to it. Once that sun is directly overhead, it really gets cooking."
I agreed, and we walked companionably toward the lobby.
"Where were you headed just now, Colonel?"
"I was just going to take a stroll out to the stables. Wanted to see what kind of horse flesh the hotel keeps. Anna has been raving about the riding here."
I wondered if it was the horses or the stable hands she was interested in, and then immediately chastised myself for thinking such uncharitable thoughts. It was true she was a flirtatious young woman, but I needed to take the high road. Even though the young woman had been rude to me the night before, I had no real reason to dislike her. "Would you like some company?" I asked.
"I would be delighted."
He beamed at me, and we took off at a leisurely pace in what I assumed was the proper direction. The grounds were extensive, and I hadn't gotten a good sense of the place yet. I was glad for the excuse to do some exploring with the colonel. We chatted easily about Egypt and travel in general as we moved away from the hotel, my companion cheerfully acknowledging the various groundskeeping staff with a tip of the head.
"Do ride."
The colonel's stick tapped along beside us, the sound muffled in the grass as we moved out onto the well-maintained paths. I know how, but I'm afraid there isn't much writing to do back in Boston. My mother had insisted that I learn as a child, but I hadn't mounted a horse since her death. While there were surely stables in the city, I had never maintained the interest. He chuckled.
I suppose not.
I didn't even know the hotel had a stable.
Do you know, they also...
Thunder drew up from behind us. I never found out what else the hotel had, because at that moment Anna Stainton pulled up beside us on an enormous chestnut gelding. As it snorted and danced in place, I had to give her credit for being able to handle such a large horse. She made it seem effortless. "Hello, Father," Anna drawled, reins clutched tightly in hand.
"Good afternoon, my child. You remember Miss Wunderly?"
"Of course." Her lip lightly curled as she looked me up and down. My own casual outfit qualified as rags compared to her short red riding coat, which covered a silky ivory blouse. The coat came just below the waist of her close-fitting taupe pants, and a pair of tall black boots and smooth leather hugged her calves, matching the black leather riding crop in her hand. She tapped the crop against her boot a few times, causing me to physically flinch. She looked as though she would like nothing better than to hit me with it. She turned her look of disgust to her father. "Your taste in company hasn't improved any, I see."
"Anna!"
A mottled red stain spread across the colonel's face as my own eyebrows shot up. Without another word, she gave a tug on the reins and kicked to the side of her mount. The horse turned tightly and took off at a gallop, leaving a cloud of dust in its wake. I had begun to sweat lightly on our walk, even though we were moving at a leisurely pace, and the storm Anna left behind stuck to my exposed skin. I felt as though I had taken a bath in sand. Coughing, the colonel turned to me, his face red and sputtering. I shook my head and smiled. "It's fine," I said. "She's young."
"I'm so sorry, Miss Wunderly."
He wiped a bit of sand from his own face.
Anna had a difficult childhood. We didn't always have much when I was just starting out, and the other children... Well, children can be cruel. And then we lost her mother."
His voice trailed off. "I understand." The colonel was obviously struggling in his effort to give me some kind of an excuse. And while there were certainly reasons behind Anna's behavior, I wasn't terribly interested in hearing them at the moment, uncharitable as it was. My enthusiasm for a walk to the stables had been well and truly spoiled. All I could think about was going back to my rooms, having a bath, and scouring the dirt from my skin. I also dreaded the idea of spending the rest of our walk listening to him apologize for his ill-behaved daughter, only to arrive at the stables and have yet another, potentially unpleasant encounter with her. "If it's all the same to you, Colonel, I think I'll head back. The heat might still be too much for me, and I need a chance to clean up before dinner." I smiled and met his eyes, doing my best to convey that I didn't hold him responsible. For a moment, he looked as though he would argue, but he relented.
"I understand, my dear. I do hope we can continue our conversation later."
He returned my smile, although a bit sheepishly. I briefly patted his arm. "Of course." We parted ways, and I retreated back the way we had come. The return trip went much quicker, not least because I had the incentive of a nice long bath at the end. But I could not help wondering what Anna meant. She obviously disliked me, but who else had the colonel been keeping company with that she disapproved of? Chapter 5. I barely made it back to my rooms before Millie stopped by and told me that I was meeting her for a drink before dinner. Rather than argue, I sighed and briefly lamented that I would not be able to take the long, luxuriating bath that I had been looking forward to. I stripped off my sandy clothes and piled them in a corner of the room, hoping to corral the dirt and sand in one small area. I crossed my bedroom into the private bathroom, and as my bare feet padded softly across the cool tile, I took a moment to appreciate the room. While I didn't have the spectacular view, the bathroom nearly made up for it. The gorgeous cobalt blue tile covering the floor was unlike anything I'd seen at home, and I found the color quite soothing. A gentle breeze came in through a high window, carrying a touch of mint from the eucalyptus trees in the garden. As I turned the gold taps on the large clawfoot tub, filling it with lukewarm water, I regarded the basket of heavenly perfumed toiletries that had been provided. I selected a jasmine-scented soap and promised myself that I would put some of the exotic bath salts to use later, when I had the time to truly enjoy them. After my too short soak in the tub, I dressed in a simple plum silk dress with sheer cap sleeves and brushed my hair until it gleamed. I didn't wear much jewelry, but I thought that the little scarab brooch Millie had given me would be the perfect touch with the dress. I searched for a few moments, but it wasn't with my other jewelry or lying out anywhere that I could see. Spinning slowly and surveying the room, I tried to recall if I had worn it the night before, but a glance at the clock told me I would have to continue my search later. Millie would not be pleased if I kept her waiting any longer. By the time I joined Millie in the lounge, she was installed at a small table in the corner, several empty glasses before her. Either she had been early, or my search had taken longer than I thought. The bar was a small but comfortable seating area off the main lobby. Tall ceilings complemented the gold-flocked wallpaper that adorned the walls. An exquisitely carved wooden canopy hung above the horseshoe-shaped bar. Without the height of the vaulted ceilings, the room may have felt incredibly closed off. Instead, it had an air of cozy exoticism. Tall windows with widely spaced beaded hangings decorated a glimpse of the closest pyramid. I still couldn't help but smile at the sight. "I can't seem to get proper table service, Jane. Why don't you head to the bar directly and get me another highball?" Millie said before I had even pulled out a chair. I crooked an eyebrow at the empty glasses on the table, but without a word, I followed her suggestion. It was hard to believe service was slow, since the hotel staff had been very attentive so far. Of course, Millie's idea of slow, especially where alcohol was concerned, was probably different than the average guest. I brought Millie her whiskey highball and took a seat as she gulped at it greedily. I placed my own sidecar on the table and decided to broach the subject of her acquaintance with the young British women again. "How do you know Lillian and Marie, Aunt Millie?" She took her time in answering, peering around the lounge as though she might be able to find a more interesting topic to distract me with. Finally, she pursed her lips. "I knew Lillian's father back in England. You were rather young, so you wouldn't remember, but your uncle and I traveled there for his work and spent nearly 2 years in London. I told Lillian's father I would keep an eye on her while we were here together." Millie took a long drink and avoided meeting my eye. "I didn't know you had plans to meet anyone here." Millie's brow drew low and her face darkened. "I don't need to tell you all of my plans, Jane." My spine stiffened at the rebuke, and I said nothing. In the awkward silence that followed, I gazed around the room. The caramel-skinned man entered and headed straight for the bar. Beside me, Millie sat upright, her eyes locked in his direction. Her reaction surprised me, especially since I didn't think she had seen his run-in with Anna the night before. "Have you met him, Aunt Millie?" I kept my voice light. "I've seen him several times, but I haven't been introduced." Millie didn't respond, but shifted in her chair several times before picking up her drink and pushing back from the table. "Let's go into dinner, Jane." She moved toward the dining room without looking to see whether I would follow. My mouth hung open for a moment before I rushed to join her. I caught up with her as she marched through the doorway to the dining room. Not only had she ignored my question and taken off, but a new awkwardness hung in the air. While we waited for the host to return to his post and lead us to our seat, Redvers appeared,
looking dapper in a brown tweed suit, breaking the continued silence between us. Air puffed out of my lungs in relief at the interruption.
"Good evening, Mrs. Wunderly," he inclined his head to my aunt. "Ma'am?"
"Mr. Redvers, I believe you already know my aunt, Millicent Stanley." As I remade the introductions, Millie eyed him up and down, her face brightening. Her relief at the interruption of our little twosome was almost palpable.
"Mr. Redvers, it's a pleasure to see you again. Will you be joining us this evening?"
Millie flashed him a wide smile as I looked at her in disbelief. She typically hated dining with strangers. Apparently, I had underestimated her desire to avoid talking with me this evening. And there was her usual goal of marrying me off.
"I would be delighted."
Redvers continued with us to our table. Talk over the meal centered on Redvers and his childhood. I wasn't surprised, as Millie was driving the conversation train and was keeping the tracks as far from my earlier questions as possible. At least, that's what I assumed. In any event, we learned all about Redvers as a youth, that he had an older brother he rarely saw. He'd had a brown and white spaniel named Mr. Jones, who died tragically when Redvers was 10, and that the boy spent summers in the small seaside town of South Shields.
"Remind me where that is exactly, Mr. Redvers?"
Millie asked.
"It's near Newcastle upon Tyne, ma'am, in the north."
"Your accent doesn't sound as though you are from the north of England, though." I glanced over at her with a cocked eyebrow. I had no idea Millie was so familiar with the various accents of the British people. Redvers also.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.